My name is Ashraf Nubani. I'm an attorney, an activist, originally from Palestine. I live in the D.C. area. I will be moderating today's session, this morning's session. And the topic is criticizing Israel within the Jewish American community based on the development of the situation. How has that opened up opportunities? We will try to focus also on Muslim-Jewish engagement to those ends. How we can bring about a larger debate or open up the debate for the benefit of education. We have three distinguished panelists, and I will start by introducing our first one, who is Josh Ruebner. And Josh is the National Advocacy Director for the U.S. campaign to end the Israeli occupation. He also is an author, a former political analyst, and may still be doing that. He has a new book, Shattered Hopes, which is Obama's failure to broker Israeli-Palestinian peace, which I encourage people to get a hold of that book to read. And he has a graduate degree from Johns Hopkins University, and he has a political science degree from the University of Michigan. And Josh will be our first speaker. Each speaker will speak for 15 minutes. And then we will open up the floor for questions and answers.
Assalamu alaikum. It's wonderful to be back here at the American Muslims for Palestine conference for, I think, the third year in a row to talk about something this morning which I don't frequently talk about because my work at the U.S. campaign to end the Israeli occupation is done through a non-sectarian frame of trying to organize all Americans from all faiths, all backgrounds, to challenge our country's complicity in Israel's oppression of the Palestinian people. So it's a pleasure for me to be speaking on something related to me more personally, but not at all representative of my work at the U.S. campaign to end the Israeli occupation. So I want to start by making it clear that my comments here today are in a personal capacity. And what I'd like to do for the next few minutes is to share with you some of the reasons why I think, as a Jewish American myself, the Jewish American community has been so historically in lockstep with supporting Israel's oppression of the Palestinian people, and to provide a few ideas on how we, and particularly Muslim Americans, can reach out to Jewish Americans to make progress towards ending this oppression. One of the reasons I think that the Jewish American community has historically been so comfortable in supporting Israel's oppression of the Palestinian people is because of the very real connection between Israel, both as a concept and as a geographic place, and the Jewish religion. And to attempt to deny or sever these links, I think, is to misunderstand why Jewish Americans tend to be so engaged in this issue. The meaning of the word Israel, or Yisrael in Hebrew, means one who struggles with God. And the word derives from the name that Jacob received after wrestling with the angel, who he later realized was God. And from this tradition of wrestling with God, Jacob was given the second name of Israel, or Yisrael. And from these, and at the risk of sounding quite ignorant about my very limited knowledge of the Bible, from Jacob stemmed the 12 tribes of Israel. So the concept of Israel is very much rooted in the theological concept of Judaism and what it means to be a Jewish person, well beyond anything having to do with the current modern-day political realities of the situation. And of course, there is a deep historical and cultural and religious connection between Judaism and the land of Israel. Now, some of you may be thinking, well, what does this have to do with the Zionist movement, with the current day Israeli colonization of Palestine? Isn't it true that the European Jews who began the Zionist movement in the late 19th century had no distinct DNA connection to those Jews who were exiled from the land of Israel by the Roman Empire 2,000 years ago? And of course, all of this is true. And yes, we know through modern-day DNA testing that most European Jews descend from the land of Khazar in modern-day Russia, when a medieval king of that kingdom converted to Judaism and all his subjects converted to it as well. We know all of this is true historically, but to say that this means that the Jewish connection, historically, religiously, culturally, to the land of Israel as a concept has no meaning is to really misunderstand how people construct identities in the modern day and era. And to this, I would point you to the really path-breaking work of Benedict Anderson, who wrote a classic study called Imagined Communities, in which he argued and drew from a vast degree of different cases throughout the world that all modern identities, all modern nationalisms in particular, are really invented constructs. And so the historical reality of a situation versus the way people identify and see themselves may be totally different from one another, but one does not invalidate the other. So one, this deep connection of the Jewish religion, of the Jewish people, historically, religiously, culturally, to the land of Israel, is a factor in understanding why Jewish Americans tend to support Israel's current day oppression of the Palestinians to such a large extent. The second factor that I'd like to raise is related to the position of Jewish Americans and the contents of their identity in modern day America. Most Jewish Americans are not really religiously Jewish. They are what the Israeli scholar Benjamin Beit Halachmi calls sociological Jews. And from this I draw from his work in Original Sin's Reflections on the History of Zionism and Israel. What did he mean when he called Jewish Americans sociological Jews? It means that for many Jewish Americans, there is no religious component of the identity. The rituals, the prayer, the traditions are in many respects foreign to them and not something that they partake of. But yet they still identify themselves as Jewish people. And so this takes on a more cultural, more sociological, and yes, even more political role. So what we've seen, as more and more Jewish Americans have really assimilated into the broader American culture and have turned away from the traditional rabbinic Judaism, is that for many Jewish Americans, Israel has come to replace religion, and that the Jewish identity is bound up with their understanding of what it means to be Jewish because they have no religious Judaism to fall back on in many cases. So Israel has in many respects become a substitute as a component of identity instead of religion for Jewish Americans. And I'd also like to make another point related to this, which is what I would call the professionalization of Jewish American life. There is a whole industry which trains young Jewish Americans to play roles in the traditional organized Jewish American community. And as the Jewish American on the individual level becomes more and more of a sociological Jewish person rather than a religious Jewish person, we see the same process at play within the organized Jewish American community, which for the most part does not exist to fulfill the spiritual and religious needs of the Jewish American community, but is set up in large part for one reason only. which is to advocate for Israel. So these sort of sociological changes that we've seen on the individual level have been transferred to the organizational life of the Jewish American community, so that for all intents and purposes, the vast majority of dollars spent by the organized Jewish American community on its communal activities is to advocate for Israel and its continuing oppression of the Palestinian people. Just as a side note, many of you are probably familiar with this program called Birthright Israel. The idea is to take young Jewish Americans and take them on a, quote, birthright tour of Israel. This was actually not envisioned originally as a political mission. It was originally seen as a way to help Jewish Americans, young Jewish Americans, especially those who were assimilating and intermarrying, return to the fold, to have them grow a Jewish identity. It was only later, when it turned out that this actually wasn't working with Birthright Israel, that it switched to a more overt propagandistic political message of trying to build political support for Israel within the Jewish American community. The third reason that I want to put forward for why I think there is so much support traditionally within the Jewish American community for Israel's oppression of the Palestinian people relates to the psychological fear that many Jewish Americans have of facing anti-Jewish bigotry and hatred, even if they've never experienced it directly. This is something that's very ingrained into the culture and the very religion, I would argue, of Judaism. And to understand Zionism as a modern-day political phenomenon, one has to understand that the Zionist movement was born out of a sense of Jewish European identity and assimilation being rejected by European Christianity. Theodor Herzl, the modern founder of political Zionism, was in no way religious. He was definitely a sociological Jew. And he maybe didn't even consider himself a sociological Jew until he experienced anti-Jewish bigotry and hatred firsthand as a correspondent for a Swiss newspaper covering the trial of Alfred Dreyfus, who was a Jewish-French soldier who was cashiered from his position on spurious anti-Semitic grounds back in the late 19th century, excuse me. And it was this rejection of assimilation, rejection of modernity, rejection of the willingness of Europe to truly integrate and assimilate Jewish people on that continent that really spurred modern-day political Zionism. And so we see that Zionism is built on a history of understanding for Jewish people that the world is always going to be hostile to them. And it's built on the persecutions of the past, instructing Jewish Americans and Jews throughout the world that the only, quote, solution to the Jewish problem is for Jews to organize themselves in a national way. It always amuses me when I hear from Israel's backers that Palestinians are obsessed with the notion of martyrdom, and they condemn this notion of martyrdom being a central component of Palestinian identity, because martyrdom is a very central component of Jewish identity and even Jewish religion. And in fact, on Yom Kippur, the holiest day of the year for Jewish people, we actually have an entire service called Martyrology, in which we go through and we expound upon all of the historical injustices and persecutions and martyrdoms that Jewish people have experienced in the past. And so even for young Jewish Americans who today have never experienced anywhere near the type of historical anti-Jewish bigotry and persecution in this country that their ancestors faced, they're nevertheless is this psychological baggage of feeling like a persecuted minority, of feeling hunted and vulnerable at any time, and this support for Israel. When it boils down to it, when I talk to my Jewish American friends, you know, maybe after two or three back and forths, It never has to do with Israel. It never has to do with the Palestinian people. It always has to do with their own personal sense of security. And now you might be thinking, well, this is not fair for the Palestinian people to have to pay for the sins of Europe and its historical anti-Jewish bigotry. And of course, I would agree with that. And some of you may also be thinking, well, if Jewish people have been oppressed so much in the past, how is it possible that they today oppress the Palestinian people? And this is a very easy notion to understand, I think. It's the same reason why children who have experienced the terrible phenomenon of being abused by their parents often grow up to abuse their own children. It's because psychological trauma is inherited and transmitted from generation to generation. So how do we break this cycle? How do we encourage more Jewish Americans to speak out against Israel's oppression of the Palestinian people? Let me leave you with 2 points. One, to try to have a quote-unquote dialogue about this with the organized Jewish American community, with the institutions that officially attempt to represent the Jewish American community is futile, because they exist, as I mentioned before, to advocate for Israel's oppression of the Palestinian people. And expecting that we can make progress through Jewish federations, through JCRCs, Jewish Community Relations Councils, through organizations like the American-Israel Public Affairs Committee, or even J Street for that matter, is simply to misunderstand their purpose. They are not interested in working with you to end Israel's oppression of the Palestinian people, but the reverse. They're interested in suppressing your voices and to make sure that the suppression continues. So who do we reach out to? We reach out to the non-organized Jewish American community. This is where the opposition is, even though this opposition is becoming more organized through organizations like Jewish Voice for Peace. And one thing that I want to stress before I conclude my remarks here is that I think it's important for Muslim Americans, for Palestinians, to affirm that there has been a history of anti-Jewish bigotry and persecution throughout the years, to affirm the psychological trauma that this has created in the minds of many Jewish Americans, and yes, to affirm the Jewish religious and historical and cultural connection to the land of Israel, of course in a way that doesn't uphold Israel's ongoing oppression and colonization of the Palestinian people. And this is what I think was the genius of the ANC, the African National Congress, in South Africa, in helping to bring about a transition to a post-apartheid democratic system in South Africa. And the genius of the ANC was, despite the ongoing oppression of black South Africans at the hands of the Afrikaners, the ANC always affirmed the role and the place and the continued existence of white South Africans in a transition to a post-apartheid regime. And I think that for many Jewish Americans, and I'll conclude here, for many Jewish Americans who truly are in this psychological trauma from persecutions of years past, it is important to reaffirm that yes, there is a role for Jewish people to continue to reside in the historic land of Palestine in a post-apartheid, post-decolonized Palestine. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Josh, for that. And this is an important insight to hear about the Jewish American community, how it's organized and what the challenges would be, of course, to engage that community. So we thank Josh for that. Our second speaker is Dr. Hatem Bazian, who is a senior lecturer at the University of California, Berkeley, also graduated from the School in Philosophy with a PhD. And Dr. Hatem is both a scholar and an activist. He's sat on several boards. He is the chairman, he's the chair of the American Muslims for Palestine, also a co-founder and board member of Zaytuna College, also a board member of MLFA, Muslim Legal Fund of America, and also Dollar for Dean, which is a scholarship fund. He's involved in that as well. He's a writer. He's an author of numerous articles about Islamophobia, about the issue of Palestine, and other other topics. So Dr. Hatem will talk to us about the challenges that activists face in trying to penetrate this the sort of American Zionism in the United States, and how people are labeled as anti-Semitic for their activism.
Assalamu alaikum. It's a pleasure to be here with you, and welcome to the AMP convention. And hopefully in my 15 minutes, I'll try to shed some light on some of the challenges pertaining to not only American Muslims, but pro-Palestine activists in this country as they undertake not only the activism to put the narrative of Palestine forward, but also as they push for PDS on college campuses and in the community, as they begin to organize non-profit support for the Palestinians, which have been criminalized by means of an intense campaign directed at Palestine work in this country. Now, to begin with, we have to understand that the American Jewish community was engaged in the Zionist project from its inception. The communication and the relations with Herzl, the World Zionist Organization, and the articulations of ideas and plans for Palestine were transatlantic. And this can be clearly evidenced for us in the issuing of the Balfour Declaration. On November 2nd, all of us understand that the declaration was issued in 1917. But the discussions and the draft took 2 years back and forth between the Jewish community in Europe as well as segments of the Jewish community in here. The Supreme Court Justice Brandeis was leading a group in the U.S. That was looking at the draft of the Balfour Declaration and making sure that the wording of the declaration reflects not only the hopes and aspirations of the Zionists, but also provide protection for Jews that are living in various countries. And that's why in the Balfour Declaration, which is an interesting statement, that the political rights of Jews in countries outside of Palestine are to be protected and not to be impacted by the Balfour Declaration, which is a unique consideration. So from the inception, there is an engagement of American Jewish community with Zionism. However, which is very important, the majority of American Jewry up to the end of the Second World War was still decisively not Zionist. Zionism in America was still a minority, and I would project also that in Europe, up to the mid-1930s, was a minority as well. So the impact of the Second World War has to be understood in the changes that took place relative to supporting the Zionist program, and then the mass migration that comes out as a result of the end of the Second World War. As far as the American Jewish community shifts, prior to this shift, the focus, one of the focus for the American Jewish community was actually in fighting anti-Semitism. The ADL was actually set up to defend and to protect the rights of Jews in America after facing considerable avalanche of anti-Semitism in the early part of the 19th century. There were a considerable cases of anti-Semitism directed at Jews. Part of the labor union and labor organizing in America was charged of being a Jewish conspiracy. And part of the capitalists and owners of many of these interests in this country. They actually targeted Jews because of their relationship to communism as the communist revolution took place. And we could see this increasing. So the ADL and other Jewish organizations internally were set up to defend and to protect Jewish civil rights in America. As the shift towards Zionism took place and the state of Israel was set up, you could see that shift moving away from solely defending Jewish American civil rights and rights in America to beginning to shift and focus on linking Israel to the US so the United States government can support Israel and see it as part of an extension of US foreign policy in the Middle East. Now, I'm going to go back a little bit to think about the Balfour Declaration was not issued by the British because of love of Jews or because of hatred of Muslims. The British issued the Balfour Declaration because they thought of it in a strategic terms to serve their imperial interest. Literally, the discussion about constituting a buffer state for Egypt, which was already a colonial possession, beginning in 1882, if not at an earlier juncture, the British had influence in Egypt. So constituting a buffer state because the north of Egypt did not have mountainous terrain because they compared it to India, and the need to constitute this buffer state, controlled access to water pathways for trade, continued to expand their influence that already were spreading in the Persian Gulf. And as such, they were thinking from those terms. In addition, they were thinking in anti-Semitic terms. Balfour himself was a very well-known anti-Semite. Many of those who were thinking about solving the Jewish question in Europe were likewise thinking in anti-Semitic terms, because in the 1880s, there was massive migration of Polish Jews and Russian Eastern Jews to England, that so much so that there was a rise in anti-Semitism. So as Herzl begins to think in nationalist terms, you could see an intensification of thinking in anti-Semitic terms in relations to Great Britain. And as such, they were hitting two birds at once, constituting a buffer state and also transferring Jewish populations from England and possibly from Europe in general. Now, for Muslims who want to engage in the political process in this country, we have to be aware of some of this history, as well as what Josh have spoken in relations to the internal dynamics of the Jewish community. Often we jump into the discussion only about the immediate circumstances that are governing Palestinian-Israeli dynamics and not thinking of the broader context that is occurring. So it's important to have this context at our disposal and be engaged with it from that perspective. Second part is that while historically Muslim-Jewish relations were not thought of in theological or... What's going on? I think the FBI is trying to record and they're having problems with the wavelength.
Copy, no problem.
That's what I said. That's why I record my classes and I just put it on iTunes so it might save the government in terms of downsizing. It'd be just easier. So historically, in terms of Muslim Jewish relations, overall we could say that...
Testing.
Yes. So overall the relations overall are positive, but we also don't want to cover over to say that there weren't any problems in the past. There are problems between minority and majority, so there's no question about it. There are different periods where those tensions can be pointed, but in general, Muslim dynamics toward Jewish communities historically has not been argued or placed on theological terms. Meaning, the Muslims do not see the Jews as responsible for the killing of Jesus. So we don't have a theology that the only way for us to affirm our religious belief is by means of eliminating what we consider to be the killers of Jesus. This is in relation to the basis of a very strong theological anti-Semitism in Europe that saw that the only way for Europe to be Christian, and you could add why, is by means of eliminating the Jews who were living within Europe, and that's where you could get into 1492 and the expulsion, which came on the heels of the massive plague that killed one-third of the European population, and the European Christian theologians were saying that the reason is because we have Jews living in our mix. And therefore, as a way for us to purify Europe, the massive expulsion of Jews as well as Muslims at the time, and to clear Europe of what they consider theologically that the problem that brought the wrath of God upon them by means of the plague. So in that sense, we don't have that type of argumentation, that type of theological discourse in Islam. While there are religious differences as far as how each particular religions develop, but you could see the inclusion throughout history of Jews in the Muslim civil society at various times. And we need to both account for the normative period, but also at the time of the difficulties and the tension. In the United States, the organized Jewish community tends to only focus on one is the history of tension or those instances of tension. So you'll find those periods are overemphasized and then projected to show that there is a very continuous line of anti-Semitism that exists in the Muslim, Palestinian, and the Arab population. And this becomes a self-serving strategy because in order to get the support of the broader American Jewish community, you have to show that there is a threat that is present across the Arab and Muslim world of rising anti-Semitism, even though that Herzl himself and the early Zionists also that you cannot end anti-Semitism, and therefore the only way for to end anti-Semitism to have a state, and the presence of the state have created anti-Semitism, so we need to continue to support the state until we can fight against anti-Semitism, which is not going to end in their perspective. So it's a circular logic in order to support the existing state in its own, in its existing framing as such. So that dynamic continues to place, and as such, many of us confront that Haj Amin Husseini constantly plays a major part in the narrative on the Palestinians, but also on the Muslims. Now, Haj Amin Husseini was recruited and worked with Nazi Germany, and we need to condemn that alliance that took place. But to say that it was Haj Amin al-Husseini that was the reason for Hitler's campaign in Europe is dumbing down of intelligence, if there's any left these days. If anything, Haj Amin al-Husseini was a very minute functionary, and if Haj Amin al-Husseini is to be blamed for meeting and engaging with us with Nazi Germany, there are a large number of Zionists who were engaged with Nazi Germany. Actually, the breaking of the boycott on Nazi Germany was undertaken by some of the Zionists themselves in trying to exchange some of their assets so they would move it to Palestine. And as such, this focus on Haj Amin Husseini is made to say that we have a strong anti-Semitic current, and basically there's an alliance between the Muslims and Nazi Germany. Now notice, there is no discussion of all the Muslims who saved Jews. There is no discussion about the mosque in France, where the mosque have taken hundreds of Jews into the mosque and protected them from Nazi Germany. And not a single one of them that were taken into the mosque were actually captured or killed by the Nazis. There is no discussion about the King of Morocco who refused the German demand that the Jews in Morocco should wear the yellow star. And actually said, these are my subjects, and I will not allow you to treat them anything other than being my citizens in this country. There's no discussions about that. There's no discussions about Tunisians or Bosnians. But the focus on Haj Amin Husseini becomes emblematic of trying to project that there's this wave and massive waves of anti-Semitism in the Arab and Muslim world that is about to do to the Jews same thing that the Nazis have done to them, and that's where you see this logic. Now, lastly, we always are being asked to have a dialogue. But the dialogue is not actually a dialogue, it's a dialogue of silencing. Meaning you are asked to come into a dialogue so you would not critique what is taking place. And those who are engaged with you in the dialogue are essentially attempting to continue the status quo. And the problem is that you are having the audacity to speak. So on college campuses, in the community, we always are being invited by, you know, whether it's the campus leadership, Hillel, the rabbi in Hillel, or the GCRC, Jewish Community Relations Council. And it's always when there is Palestinian activism taking place, or that the Palestinians are organizing something. In essence, the discourse is to silence the debate, because if there is no debate, if there is no discussion, if there is no real challenge, people will not change their opinion. People will not be exposed to new and different information overall. So the dialogue is a dialogue of silencing that is taking place from the organized Jewish community. There is a serious dialogue taking place. For example, AMP is committed to constantly engaging in dialogue with Jewish Voice for Peace. We also work with Tikkun. We work with the International Anti-Zionist Organization. We work with Nutri Carta, who always are on our conference. So the issue is not Muslim-Jewish relations. It's Muslim-Arab-Palestinian relations that are being said that you are too vocal, you're antagonizing the status quo, that you're not celebrating Israel as an achievement, and therefore what we want is to make you understand how central and important Israel as a modernity project. And I have a critique about this whole accepting modernity in relations to European discourse, which is highly racist, highly colonial, as it relates to how Israel relations, particularly in relations to American Jews, is being defined. And I think those critiques have to be constantly there as we speak. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Hatem, for that. I think so far the speakers have laid the groundwork for hopefully a vibrant question and answer session, because that gives us the platform to ask the questions in terms of going forward. I think that we got the basics about the challenge that we face going forward and how to deal with it. Our final speaker, last but not least, is Miko Peled, who is known for the book The General's Son. He's an author, and that's an Israeli's journey in Palestine. And he will be talking about basically his experiences, because I think that that gives an example of maybe a transformation from people, from individuals within the Jewish American community into the realm of fighting for justice for all. So with no further ado, Miko Peled.
The 2 minutes is not for me yet, right?
No, not.
This morning we were having, there's a room upstairs for the speakers, and somebody brought me a latte, and Ahmed Tibi is looking at me and he's going, I want one too, how come the Jew's getting one and I'm not? He was joking, of course. Anyway, so I was going to say, how come he gets so much time and I don't? Anyway, it's a pleasure to be here. It's always a pleasure. So, I didn't say that.
That's why, because the microphone was acting up, we're getting extra time. You will get extra time too if it keeps
acting up. Get your wires right. Anyway, it's a pleasure to be here at AMP again. It's a pleasure to hear Josh and, of course, the great precision of Dr. Hatem. It's always great to hear. I learn so much when I hear you speak. You're always so precise. Should I wait with this or should I keep going?
Keep going well.
Okay. Okay. It's interesting sitting here right in front of the rabbis from the Nutri Carta and talking about Jewish victimhood, talking about Jewish theology, you know, when there's this...
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim.
They're taking care of them right now.
fix that.
إن الله
In front of our friends from the Turekarta and talk about Jewish victimhood is so absurd, because they represent, you know, this real fighting Jewish spirit. And to talk about Jewish theology again in the light of their being once again the experts on Jewish theology. So these are two things that I'm going to stay away from. And also this idea that that being anti-Zionist is anti-Semitic. And looking at these, highly observant and respectful Jewish people, again, puts in light how absurd it is that we talk about anti-Zionism as though it was anti-Semitism. So I appreciate your presence here. And again, talking about this idea of a Jewish community. I'm sure the Jewish community that likes to call itself the Jewish community does not include the Neturikarta, who represent, you know, such strong Jewish values and Orthodox or Jewish Orthodoxy. So there's this idea, I think there's this notion of a Jewish community. Whenever people talk about the Jewish community, I always say, well, what is this Jewish community? Does it include them? Does it include me? It doesn't. But these are people who have, typical of Zionist rhetoric, you know, decided that they are the Jewish community and that they represent Jews. I remember in San Diego last year, there was in the local news, it was said that the Jewish community is in uproar because in the San Diego State University, in the Arabic 101 class, there's a chapter where they learn about the Arab world, and they showed a map of the Middle East, of the Arab world. And God forbid, it said Palestine.
For the other side.
And yeah. And it was in the local news that the Jewish community was in uproar. And I saw.
I the other one all the way down.
I don't see it. I didn't see Jews in the streets protesting. I didn't see Jews rioting. Why? What is this nonsense about the Jewish community is in uproar? Okay. First of all, why uproar? Half the world calls that country Palestine, and half the people who live there call it Palestine. So why is there a problem? But, you know, a small group of ultra-fundamentalist Zionists decided they had a problem with calling Palestine Palestine and not Israel. But it was out there. The Jewish community is in uproar, which means all the Jews must be on the streets protesting and rioting because somebody dared to call it Palestine, Palestine. But I think this is typical of the discourse in this country. They've hijacked the idea of the Jewish community. And again, I don't think there's a Jewish community. There's lots of communities that happen to be Jewish. And they present themselves as the Jewish community. What they really are is a Zionist community. They're a community that has a lot of ability to make a lot of noise. They do have influence. They do have funds. But I think they don't represent anything that's Jewish, they represent Zionism. And when we look at events of, you know, conferences like this one, Sabil conference, when we look at the SJP, the Students for Justice in Palestine conference, we see a lot of Jewish people. You know, none of us are wearing a t-shirt that says, I am Jewish. We happen to be Jews, we support this cause, this is why we're here. You know, our Jewishness is not the issue, our humanity is the issue. And the beauty of a conference like this is that it brings our humanity out, because this is an issue where we can all, you know, all of us that share the values of justice and human rights and equality, you know, are here. That's why we're here. And of course, none of us who are here are represented by that Jewish community because we're not Zionists. And I think that's very important to clarify. A friend of mine, a young man who was at this SJP conference, said he was encouraged and quite amazed to see so many Jewish students who are not only part of SJPs around the country, but sometimes initiate and hold office within SJP on campuses, which is of course a good thing, it's a natural thing. Again, it's not about being Jewish, it's about supporting the right cause. And I think it's also important to remember that the Zionists, we heard a lot about the Zionists here, secularized the Bible and turned it into a history book, which is why it was easy for them to deal with some of the European Christians who read the Bible literally. And they also nationalized Judaism. And for those two reasons, in the beginning, it was very hard for them to get any Jewish support. And if we look at some of the Jewish literature from, you know, the early 20th century, you know, there's always a sense in the Jewish family that, God forbid, our kids will either become socialists or Zionists, because we know those are crazy people. You know, so this was part of the Jewish culture. You know, nobody wanted their kids to be Zionists. It was a crazy idea. I think it's still a crazy idea. And the fact remains that most Jews don't live in Israel and probably haven't accepted Zionism. But I think this is important to put in perspective. There's nothing religious about Zionism, and there's nothing, certainly nothing Jewish about it, and there's nothing Jewish about Israel. The Zionists being a racist colonialist movement, Israel being a racist colonialist apartheid state that happens to give exclusive rights to Jewish people on Palestinian land. They call it a Jewish state, but again, I don't think there's anything Jewish about it. That's really, I think, what the definition of the state of Israel should be. And another thing that they did, and Dr. Hatem really brought to light well, is that they, because the majority of Israelis are not descendants of European Jews, the majority of Israelis today are the descendants of Arab Jews, of Jews who came from Arab countries, and did not have this experience of European anti-Semitism, they are now being indoctrinated as though the European experience was their experience. So they are taken in high school to Auschwitz and all these places and taught the Holocaust, so they would internalize and personalize the Eastern European Jewish experience and forget what was largely a positive experience, which was the experience of Jewish life in the Arab world, which is of course why most Arab Jews did not want to come, did not become Zionists, did not want to come to Palestine, and that was a whole other issue, did not want to come to Israel. I'll share a little story with you. You know, when the state of Israel was established, the Jews weren't coming. The vast majority of Holocaust survivors didn't go to Israel, didn't immigrate. Only a small percentage went. The American Jews didn't come. You know, none of the Jews that they wanted, the white rich Jews, came. So at some point they decided, well, we need to bring the Arab Jews, and of course the Arab Jews weren't interested. The Iraqi Jews, the North African Jews, I mean, they wanted to stay where they were. So the Mossad sent cells, and the reason we know that they sent these cells is because they were caught. They sent cells, one cell was caught in Baghdad and one cell was caught in Egypt. My father's best friend growing up as a child was a part of that cell, and he sat in Iraqi jail for 10 years. They put bombs in synagogues in order to scare the Jewish community so they would think there's anti-Semitism and they would immigrate. And I remember the stories, he would always tell stories. By the time I knew he'd already been released, my father's friend, and he would always tell stories about Iraq and about the jail and all of this. We never really put it together until later on in life. That's what he was doing there. He was part of that Mossad cell. The cell in Egypt was caught, and Israel would not recognize them and what replaced them, wouldn't allow them to come in a POW exchange until 1973. So they sat in the Egyptian jail for some 20, 25 years. But that was the reality, and I think it's important to bring that to light as well. There's nothing inherently Jewish about Zionism. And growing up, you know, I grew up as a very, very patriotic Zionist. My grandfather was one of these early Zionist leaders. He was a signer of the Israeli Declaration of Independence, a very secular European Jew. He adored the British. And all of these, you know, all of these early Zionist leaders, they didn't look Jewish, they shaved, they didn't really believe in all this, you know, Jewish religion. They spoke many languages. They were kind of people that the Europeans and the Americans felt that they could do business with because they looked white and they looked, you know, civilized. And of course, we all believed that this is what it meant to be a Jew. And the sense of being raised as a Zionist, the sense of being raised as an Israeli, and we see this in Israel to this day, and we can see it in the results of the elections in Israel, last elections. What defines you as an Israeli is hatred of two things: hating the Arabs and hating Orthodox Jews. That is what defines you as a good Israeli. And I remember, I grew up in Jerusalem, and I remember the Orthodox neighborhoods in Jerusalem. And on the one hand, we have this yearning and admiration for the ultra-Orthodox. On the other hand, we know that, you know, they're not really good people because they're anti-Zionist. And so we hate them, and we hate the Arabs. And when we look at some of the younger politicians, up-and-coming politicians in Israel, that's what defines them. And that's why they're so successful. And that's what it means to be an Israeli and a Zionist. So that was my background. Of course, my father was in the Israeli army. He was a general in 1967. And that generation of generals of that generation, thank you, I don't think I need it. They were the young officers who fought and won the war of 1948. So they were the ones who handed us the Jewish state, you know, handed us a Jewish homeland after 2,000 years in exile. And then they defeated the Arabs once again in 67 and gave us this glorious victory. You know, as growing up as an Israeli, especially with that background, this was the backdrop. This is what I learned, and this is what I knew and believed firmly. And like Josh was saying, this happens in Israel too. Zionism took the place of religion. Zionism took the place of a spiritual life. We believed in this new thing. And that's exactly how it was. And people always ask me, so what is it that, how did the change happen? You know, what happened? You know, why are you now here talking about, you know, Palestinian rights and so forth? And it's hard to say exactly what happened, but there were several stages, and it wasn't just me, it was my entire family that went through that brought me and the rest of us to this point where we become advocates of Palestinian rights. There's a story that I always mention that people like to hear, and it's in my book, where a story that my mother told me of an experience that she had in 1948. She was born and raised in Jerusalem, to a secular Zionist family, of course. By 1948, she was already a mother, a young mother, and she was living in a small apartment with her parents. And when the Zionist forces took the Palestinian neighborhoods in Jerusalem, in West Jerusalem, of course, they expelled the people, and these homes, after they were looted, were made available to Jewish families. And they're still there, many of them are still there, these homes, these very beautiful neighborhoods. And she was offered one of these homes, and she refused to take it. She said, how could I possibly move into the home of another mother? And growing up, I always realized this was a good story, but there was something about it that was really troubling me. And only later in life I understood what was troubling about it. What was troubling about it is that she was contradicting the national narrative, because the national narrative always, the Zionist narrative always ends up with us being holding the moral high ground. You know, we returned to our land. We accepted the partition because we're good people and we thought that the Arabs deserve a little bit of the country as well. We were attacked and we won. Then we asked the Arabs to stay and they left. Well, they left, leaving these beautiful homes empty. There's no moral dilemma in taking a home that was deserted. So why was my mother wouldn't she take the home? Why was she presenting a moral dilemma where there's clearly no moral dilemma? You know? And this is typical of Zionist discourse today too. We murdered over 2,000 people in cold blood in Gaza, knowing full well they never held a gun and never posed a threat. But it's okay because Hamas is in Gaza. So morally we're okay, there's no dilemma. And if you talk to Israelis during the last massacre in Gaza, that's what they would tell you. There's no moral dilemma. Israelis are supporting it. And so this was kind of, so my mother's story was really the first stage. Then later on, after 1967, my father retired from the military as a, you know, being part of that glorious group of generals. And he and several other Israeli Zionists realized or thought that you could hold back Zionism and somehow find a compromise. So we could have a Jewish state, which was already, before 1967, a clearly racist apartheid regime, because many of the apartheid laws were passed very early on in the life of the state of Israel. We could have it on part of Palestine, and then compromise on the West Bank and Gaza and allow the Palestinians some rights. And then he and several other Israelis fought for this and advocated for this idea of rights for Palestinians within that small part of Palestine, thinking you could rein in racism and you could rein in colonialism. Of course, we know that colonialism just cannot be reined in, which is why it always falls. Racism and apartheid regimes fall because they have no limits to their voracious hunger. So as he and others were talking about the need for a Palestinian state, and this was when the whole idea of a two-state solution based on the state in the West Bank and Gaza emerge and so forth, Israel was, of course, not paying any attention to this. But suddenly I was hearing a thing about Palestinian rights and the and Palestinians, because we don't say Palestinians in Israel, we just say Arabs. And then, you know, later on in life, and again, I talk about this at length in my book, I was driven to actually meet with Palestinians. And the first time I met Palestinians was not in Jerusalem, where I was born and raised, but here in the U.S. And it was the first time I actually sat and talked to Palestinians, because Israel is a very segregated place. And it was the very first time that I was with Palestinians in the same place, and we were equal. Because in all of Palestine, there's not a single city, neighborhood, situation where Israelis and Palestinians are equal. And here suddenly we were in the U.S., we were sitting in somebody's house, and we were talking, and we were equal, and then, you know, that opened some serious possibilities in my mind. You know, the potential of an Israeli-Palestinian partnership, as opposed to this idea that we are masters and they have to follow our rules, was very liberating. And that kind of drove me, and really meeting and sitting and talking and hearing Palestinians, and then traveling myself into the West Bank, into Palestinian cities within 1948 and so forth, was the eye-opener that really drove me to this realization and an understanding of what Zionism is and why it's wrong and why it really is a racist colonialist ideology and so forth. So, in closing, I think it's really, really important to, number one, deal with this issue and not be afraid of talking about how it began, not being afraid to talk about how Israel began, talk about the ethnic cleansing, remember that the state of Israel was born as a result of a crime, horrific crime of terrorism and ethnic cleansing, nothing heroic about it. We can't separate what happens in Gaza today from the ethnic cleansing, because the reason we have refugee camps and we have a problem in Gaza today is a result of the ethnic cleansing. And put it all back in perspective and put Palestine back in as a whole unit, and then we can understand how to resolve it. And to talk about this issue and not talk about a resolution, to talk about this issue and not see the connection between what happens today and what happened in 1948 and how this began is criminal. We have to talk about the end of Zionism just like people had to talk about the end of apartheid. Just criticizing the apartheid regime is not enough. You have to talk about how we remove it and end it. Buying into this idea that we could have a two-state solution is nonsense. There is no way to rein in the Zionist regime. It has to be replaced by democracy. And it all makes sense if we have the complete picture, which of course why people like to divvy it up and not deal with the complete picture. You know. And the last thing I'll say is, you know, I have a sticker, a bumper sticker on my car that says Free Palestine. And I think it's really clear, it's really important to be clear about what that means. And it means freeing all of Palestine and freeing all the people in Palestine from this very racist regime. And this will be good for not only Palestinians, but for Israelis and Jews as well.
Thank you, Miko Peled, for that. Folks, I have to apologize to you because we're supposed to end at 12 o'clock. We got started late because of the previous session. So I don't know if the organizers will let us know, for those who are able to stay a little bit beyond, we will do that, because I don't see how we're going to ask and answer questions. I'm going to caution the audience, please ask a question as quickly and as concise as possible, and I will ask the speakers to do as well in their responses. And thank you for your patience for the sound issue and me playing musical chairs with myself, unfortunately. And because of my vision, you need to raise your hand or stand so that I can see you. The first lady, I spotted this lady here to start. Do you need the mic?
I don't know if anyone can hear me or not.
Well, we can hear you. Thank you.
Good morning,
thanks to the three of you. It's very informative. I've been following Palestine and the Palestinian leaders, and one thing that I think is missing all the time that I keep waiting for is that they will acknowledge the suffering of Jews in Europe. You know, they talk about what happened to them, and I know it, and it should never have happened, but if you're to penetrate what Josh spoke about, the feeling among Jews that another Hitler could show up, or sometime in the future, they need a safe place to be.
I haven't heard any Palestinian leader or any religious leader, Christian or Muslim, get up publicly and say, I know your story, I know your history, I know what Europe did to you for centuries, from the pogroms in Eastern Europe leading up to Hitler. I think that they have to penetrate that just like a psychologist giving therapy. At least acknowledge it and say, I know it, and I know why you're scared, and I know why you need safety and you need some assurance, but I haven't heard it from any of them. I think it would help if they would do it.
Okay, thank you, that's very clear. I'll have Josh and Miko to begin with, and then have Hatem to respond. Would you? Okay, then let's do that. Maybe that'll be quicker. Gentleman over here.
I am hearing the panel says that the major Jewish organizations are Zionist organization, not representing the Jews. Although they're very powerful and they have a lot of membership and they're very rich, while the modest Jewish organization like Jewish Voice for Peace and the Orthodox Jews are very small and hardly heard, with all the respect. I'm playing the devil advocate here and saying that most Jewish organizations represent Jews and not only Zionists.
I'm just curious on a really micro level, like what you guys suggest for, like I grew up Catholic, but my sister converted to Judaism when she got married, and so her family's Jewish, and my nephew just had his bar mitzvah, and now like my family's really split over this situation, and I just looking for suggestions. Thanks.
Thank you. On this side, the rabbi, and then I will go over there.
First of all, thank you so much for the excellent speeches. I would suggest we should have the recordings of this and present it to Jewish communities. It's really, really important. But in specific, what Josh said before, the reasons behind Zionism, I totally agree. It's so true. One of the questions should be, what's the solution for these problems? And let me add one other thing, what I find in my experience with religious Jewish people who originally are anti-Zionist, as Miko said, the main problem we face is, in many of our communities, is today's threat. They're going to kill us. They're out to kill us. Now, we here in this room know exactly how false this is, but what can we do as Jews, as Muslim people, to overcome this, help Jewish people to overcome this? That there is no hate, there won't be any hate if there wouldn't be this occupation.
Thank you.
Yes. Thank you for all the panelists for their great presentations. My question is how we can build a better platforms for Muslims and Jews to come and listen to these kind of thoughtful analysis of what's going on, what happened. I think creating a platform, this is a good platform, but I know that most of the audience here are Muslims, and we need to hear from the other part of the aisle about Jewish, how we can create those platforms where Muslims and Jews can come and discuss this history and come up with a vision that we can move forward. Thank you.
Thank you. There's more questions. Do you want to take these on, or a couple? You want to start with these?
Yeah.
Okay, let's do that. I'll come back if we have time. Thank you, folks. Musical microphones.
I have to say that I don't accept the premise of the first question at all. I think that Palestinian, not just Palestinian, Arabs in general, but certainly Palestinian leaders up and down from all the way, all the different movements, parties, religious denominations, clearly say and have been saying for decades that they recognize the suffering of Jews, they recognize that the Holocaust was a terrible thing. They say it so many times that sometimes it makes me feel, okay, we heard you, thank you very much. How many times can you repeat this? So I don't accept at all that this is missing. I think perhaps it's not being represented properly. Perhaps some people are not hearing it or choose not to hear it, but I really don't accept that they haven't been saying this or acknowledging this. And I certainly don't accept that Jews need a refuge. I think the refuge for Jews is the same refuge as it is for all people. The solution, the answer to the Holocaust is not the creation of a so-called Jewish state on Palestinian land. The answer to the Holocaust is tolerance everywhere. The answer to the Holocaust is fighting racism and colonialism everywhere, which I believe is why most Holocaust survivors did not end up going to Israel and Palestine, because they realized that this was another colonialist, racist project, and they had no interest in this. Many of them wanted, and many of the Holocaust survivors that did go to Israel left because it was the racism, and there was racism against them. As Jews, as people who went through this horrible experience. And so I think, you know, tolerance is the solution. Fighting racism everywhere is the solution, because if there's anti-Semitism, there's also other forms of racism. Anti-Semitism is one aspect of a larger problem, which is racism in general. And if we want to fight anti-Semitism, we have to fight racism everywhere. So I really think that this is a key issue to bring to light. It's not true, and it's not. In Palestine.
I remember that back in the 1990s, when the Holocaust Museum opened up in Washington, D.C., PLO chair Yasser Arafat wanted to come to Washington, D.C., and to visit the museum as part of this recognition of the suffering of the Jewish people historically, and it was billed as this, you know, sort of huge step toward potential reconciliation between Israelis and Palestinians. And the governmental-run Holocaust Museum, a governmental-funded Holocaust museum, denied Yasser Arafat the right to visit this museum and to make a statement about the Holocaust. So I think that the Jewish American community, the organized Jewish American community, the Zionist movement, the State of Israel, wants to keep alive this pretense, as Dr. Hatem mentioned, that Palestinian opposition to Israel's oppression is a continuation of historical anti-Semitism. And as Miko mentioned, Palestinians have done their best to try to recognize this pain inflicted on the Jewish people and to move forward with it constructively. To the question about joint conferences and platforms for Jewish people and Muslim people to get together. Since I have Dr. Hatem here, maybe let me put forward the idea of a joint American Muslims for Palestine and Jewish Voice for Peace conference. I think that would be very powerful to have that kind of platform to interact and to get to know one another and to plan joint strategies for ending Israel's oppression of the Palestinian people. Let me say one word about hatred and fear. I think anytime you have a situation where one group of people is responsible for oppressing another people, the people on the side of receiving the oppression must necessarily be dehumanized by the oppressor. Because if the oppressed is not dehumanized in the mind of the oppressor, you can't continue the oppression. If you recognize the fundamental humanity of the person you're oppressing, it's simply no longer tenable, which is why your mother's story was such a threat to the Zionist narrative. And conversely, in order to maintain these systems of oppression and dehumanization of the other, it has to be built on hate. It has to be built on fear. It has to be built on a narrative of, if I don't continue this oppression, the oppression is going to come back to me. And we saw this same dynamic play itself out in the perpetuation of oppression in places as varied as France's colonial presence in Algeria, or the apartheid regime in South Africa, or more closer to home, slavery in this country. where these structures of oppression were upheld by this fear amongst the oppressors that if they let down their guard, if they stopped the oppression, then they would get back what was coming to them. And subconsciously, I think, many of the oppressors actually recognize the oppression that they're inflicted, but shoot up all kinds of ego defense mechanisms to pretend that it doesn't happen. So how exactly do we break through that circle of hate and fear? Again, I would go back to some of the comments I made in my presentation. It's about affirming, reaffirming the fears that are out there and that are legitimate. I mean, you can't tell someone not to be scared. If people are fearful, they're going to be fearful. And you can't tell them there's no rational basis for you not to be fearful, because fear is not a rational feeling. So, you know, to break through this is to reaffirm the insecurity that many oppressors face, and to recognize that there is a place for them in a post-apartheid, post-decolonized Palestine.
On the first question, I think the fact you're not hearing the statements that are coming from Arab Muslim leadership, both in here and abroad, is because the microphone is not given to them. And the focus on the TV, on the press, is anyone that deny the Holocaust, they get 24/7 coverage. They become the Fox News focus, and therefore we begin to project that all the Muslims and all the Arabs, all the Palestinians are Holocaust deniers. So that's, I think, one is that the microphone and the camera is not on them. Second is that even if they say it, we don't hear it, because at the same time we present that they really are engaged in ulterior doublespeak. And this is the whole concept of taqiyya, that they are really not meaning what they're saying. They just want to, you know, speak certain things just to placate us. And as such, they're not honest or forthright with it. The third is part of Zionist narrative today is that there is a threat today from the Arab and Muslim world. And that gets me into the production of Islamophobia. The overwhelming majority of Islamophobic discourse that is being put into civil society is produced by pro-Zionist, pro-Israel actors. Pamela Geller, David Horowitz, Daniel Pipes, Stephen Emerson, all of these infrastructure that you see that are spewing out such a hateful message against Arabs and Muslims on 24/7 is done to give the rationalization for both the Zionist community as well as an alliance with the modern colonial that wants to continue to expand and control much of the Arab and Muslim world resources and markets, as well as access. So that has to be understood in there. As far as the question of having a different platform, we are constantly working as AMP with Jewish Voice for Peace and as Sabil. And actually the idea of hosting a joint conference, we had discussed it. We were trying to do it in Chicago, and the plans are still back and forth between the three organizations. As Sabil, which is the voice of the Christian Palestinians, Jewish Voice for Peace, and AMP. So those plans are still in the mix to discuss them, and I think that will take place in the future. On a regional level, we're all participating constantly in each other's regional conferences in a much more proactive way. So I think in that sense, there is that engagement in there, the Palestinian Christians, the Muslims, and the Jewish community, but also not to leave the broader pro-Palestine movement, which is not only made up of these three groups. So in essence, U.S. campaign is likewise an organization that have been able to bring us under one umbrella, both the secular, religious, those who are coming to it from a cultural, ethnic, all those organizations are working together, and I think that's a positive platform as well that has created some really major impact across the board.
Thank you. folks, we are 10 minutes after, and so I think that I'm going to take the prerogative and to stop it here. I apologize for those that we didn't get to their questions, but we want to continue the program. I want to remind people that Miko's book and Josh's book, they will be available for signing at the AMP table, the General's Son and Shattered Hopes. So please take the time to visit them at the AMP table for the signing. And Dr. Hatem has a book that's coming up, I understand.
Either December or January. It's Palestine. It's a colonial idea.
Okay, so look forward for that book as well. Thank you very much. We apologize for going over, and also the problem with the sound. Thank you for the speakers.